Well, it's great to see you guys this morning, and thankful that you're here. If you have a Bible, and I hope you do, you might want to turn to the book of Mark this morning. We're gonna dive into a spot there in just a little bit. We'll kind of be all over the place, but Mark chapter 12. If you have bulletin, you might want to take out your notes and take some notes and things like that. So, and remember to fill out your communication card and take that to the welcome area so they can give you some info. We are in the third week of our series that we're calling Be Rich. And we've been talking about this because we believe that in our world today, there's lots of voices out there telling us how to get rich, but very few who are telling us what to do once we are. And so in week one, we all discovered something that we might not readily admit, and that's this reality. We're rich. How many of you are rich this morning? Anybody rich? Okay. Yeah, we discovered in week one, we're creepy crawling our way through this passage of Scripture, and we had to take a couple weeks on this part because we had to establish this reality in our life, because sometimes we don't realize it. Yesterday, I realized that I got to go hiking and spend some time with some really good friends, and we were down in Dana Point and walking along the beach, and we're surrounded by, in this place where the cheapest house is like $5 million. But what was amazing is I'm looking at these houses, I'm going, those are pretty nice, but then to look out at the ocean, and I'm thinking, God, you're way better than us. And it was just absolutely gorgeous. But so we've taken some time to establish this, and so I want you to read this with me just because this is the passage that we just want to seep into us. So read this along with me. It's on the little cards or in your notes. It's up here too. So read this along with me. Read it out loud with me. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their wealth in, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. And so we've been over here. We've just been on this board right now. And we realize that, number one, we are rich. Okay, we're in the top 1% of people in the world. And we have issues that 99% of the other people in the world don't have. But what we discovered also is this, is that wealth has side effects. You see those commercials on TV? Aren't they crazy? And they show the different drugs that you can take for different things. And then at the end of the commercial, they list all the side effects, right? Which just cracked me up, because I saw one just the other day, and it was like, you know, you can get rid of your toe fungus, okay? Which, you know, if you got toe fungus, yeah, you want to get rid of it. But the side effect is if you take this drug to get rid of the toe fungus, then it may cause kidney or liver disease, certain forms of cancer and everything else. And I'm like, let's just stick with the toe fungus, right? But the wealth that we have, it tends to have side effects. And one of the potential side effects of our wealth, of living where we live and having what we have, one of the potential side effects that we discovered was we could be arrogant. We could start to believe that our wealth gives us certain privilege, that our wealth, we talked about, we think it even increases our IQ, which that's ridiculous, because rich people do some of the dumbest stuff sometimes, especially with their money. And so being arrogant is a possible side effect, because we start thinking like we have more, so maybe we're better, and that demonstrates itself in all kinds of ugly ways in our lives. So God commanded, he said, hey, for those of you who are going to be rich, I've got some teaching for you specifically for rich folks like us. And that's this passage, because he starts out and he says, command those who are rich in this present world. And I have to go, woo, that's me. We are so blessed. And so then he says, now watch out, because don't be arrogant, because that's one side effect. The other side effect is don't put your hope in wealth, which is so uncertain. We talked about that last week. But you see, one other side effect is you could have a misplaced hope. Okay, you can misplace your hope. You can start to put your hope in your stuff. And last week we talked about how it's crazy, and we discovered that many of us, whether we admit it or not, we might actually be hoarders, okay? Not the ones like on the TV show, okay, where you can't like get in their house, but we talked about how we even have this tendency to go out and rent little apartments for all of our extra stuff, right? And then we pay all this money so that we can store stuff that we rarely see, and so that we can just know that we have stuff, because sometimes our misplaced hope is because we want to find security somewhere, and we think that our security might be found in our stuff. Now, this week, I got to tell you, because I was thinking about that, and I know people were laughing about that last week, and we laugh usually the most at things that are true about us. And so this week I was looking, and I got this ad in the mail for Hollywood Storage, okay? And it was really funny, because then I saw this little thing, and so I looked it up online, and I discovered this. Not only can you go over and pay for a little apartment for your stuff, but this is what caught my attention. They have special storage areas, and they have climate-controlled storage. Okay, and what that means is this: you can air condition your stuff, right? And you know, they're saying, well, you know, certain things, sensitive things, things you want to last, you know, or for people who are wine connoisseurs, they have special, you know. And I'm thinking, my mind is just kind of wanting to blow up, right? Because I'm thinking to myself, like, I've been to lots of these amazing places around the world that God's let me go to, and I'm thinking to myself, like, all the Cambodian pastors that I spent time with, none of them have air conditioning, and it's hot and horrible there. And I'm thinking, our junk is living better than these pastors and people that I know of. In fact, our junk lives in nicer places than probably 80% of the people in the world. I'm thinking, this is sick. We've got, you know, we really do have a problem. And the problem starts when we misplace our hope. And that is so huge. We can't misplace our hope. And so now today we're making the switch. So God says, look, command those who are rich, that's us, not to be arrogant, okay? So don't go being arrogant about your stuff. And don't put your hope in your wealth, okay? So now what are we supposed to do? Okay, well, here's what you're supposed to do, but put your hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. And that's what we're going to talk about for a few minutes today. Put your hope in God, who richly provides you with everything for our enjoyment. You know, I mean, because wealth is, it's so uncertain. I mean, have you looked at the little thing? I looked at this thing this week of the stock market. And you just look over the last several years, and it's a day-by-day little thing. You can get a graph. You can just go online, put daily graph of the you know, U.S. stock market, the New York Stock Exchange. And, I mean, the thing's just like, if your heart beat like that, they would do surgery. Okay, the thing's just all over the place. It's uncertain. And on any given day, it can be just like, boom, and it's like, you know, it's down, and then it's up, and it's down, it's up. It's just all over the place. And unfortunately, so are our attitudes oftentimes about finances. They're all over the place too. And so we don't want to put our hope in wealth. We want to put our hope in God, because But what happens is that in our culture today, so many of us, like we said, we equate our security. When you stop and you think about this whole idea of hope, what is hope? Okay, because you're not supposed to put your hope in wealth. You're supposed to put your hope in God. Well, hope, we put our hope in all kinds of things when you think about it. I mean, when I first asked Brenda out on a date, I hoped she'd say yes, right? I mean, that was hope. When you make an investment, okay, especially like if you do make an investment in the stock market or whatever, you hope that that stock will go up, that you'll get an increase. That's what you're hoping for, right? If your child's goldfish flipper dies, okay, goes belly up, you hope that when they come home that they don't see that that one you put in there is a replacement goldfish, okay? Because that could be like, that could be hard, okay? That could be crazy. I mean, that's, you hope, and what hope is this idea that we want a favorable future outcome. We want a favorable future outcome. So if I ask Brenda, the favorable outcome is she says yes, and thank goodness she did, okay? And so that's what's happening. So, but these are all things that are just kind of temporary and earthly. The reality is in this passage, this idea of hope is like, put your future, stake your future on this, stake your eternity on this. Because a lot of people, they're staking their future on wealth. And that's why they try to accumulate. And that's why in Ecclesiastes 5:10, it says, whoever loves money never has money enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income. And so then we don't have enough. Even though we spend everything we have and we fill up our storage units and everything else, instead of being satisfied, we want more. And so in our country, we've made it just handy for us to get more. And so we have this thing called credit. Right, and according to the U.S. reports that I read, the U.S. consumer debt today is at $3.4 trillion. The average American household, okay, carries $16,000 in credit card debt. Okay, the average American household, $16,000. Now that means that there's some of you in this room who are like, the average is 16,000. Some of you are going like, yeah, we're doing good. Okay, we don't have that much. And some of you are like, oh man, we're in trouble, right? Because, I mean, that's just average. And the reason that we do that is why? Because we put our hope in stuff. And God, the problem with that is that Proverbs chapter 22, verse 7, it says, the rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is the slave to the lender. I mean, those of you who have that kind of credit card debt, you know that it enslaves. It enslaves you. Those of you who are carrying lots of debt, you know, because you feel the shackles of your debt. And the reality is why God is telling us this is because God does not want you to be enslaved to anything at all. Jesus died on the cross to bring you freedom, to bring you hope. Not so that you could go get yourself enslaved to other stuff. And so we don't put our hope in these riches. We put our hope in God. Now, because where you put your hope says a lot about what you put your trust in. And ultimately, it tells us where our heart is. Okay? Where we put the things that we value most, it tells us where our heart is. Now, the way I know this is true is that when I was growing up, I remember the first two items. You know, when I was in like high school and college, to me at the time, a lot of money, like man, that's a lot of money, was like $1,000, right? And I remember being in college, and I remember the first two things that I spent $1,000 on, okay? And the first thing was, I'd been working out on the construction sites for my dad and everything. I'd saved up, and I bought an old 69 Chevy Camaro, okay? Yeah, and all the men in the room are like, oh, yeah, all right, yeah, okay? And it was a good one, okay? It was this model. I had the 327 engine. It was all great, and it was awesome. So I proceeded, though, to not just spend some money on this car to buy it, but then once I got it home, and in the garage, me and my buddies, we like took this thing apart. We rebuilt the engine. And all of a sudden, all of my money is going to this car. Okay? I mean, every spare bit of money that I had was going to improve this car. Why? Because I thought this car would make me cool. Okay? And in one sense, I was like, yeah, it was a cool car, but then something else happened in my life that was kind of interesting, is because around the same time, this girl started hanging around. And, you know, we started becoming friends, And she would actually come over, and while I was working on this car, she would tip this bucket, 5-gallon bucket, over in the garage, and she would sit, and she would just sit there while I was working on the car. And when I look back now, I'm thinking, man, she was committed. She's just hanging out there. And then, but here's the other reality, is I found out she hated that car. Okay? And now you might start to want to be able to understand why, right? Because that car had my heart, right? Every bit of money went into that car. Everything it had, boom, you know, I'm buying new carburetors and new this and new that and new everything else. So it's like, and even though she would come and hang out, she feels the tension there because, and then this weird thing happened and it started to switch. Because all of a sudden, I was like, okay, new rims for the car. Take Brenda on a date. I know. And see, you guys out there going, oh, man, dilemma. And you women out there, like, want to throw something at me, right? You're like, why would you be that stupid, right? Well, so fast forward, the second thing that I spent at least $1,000 on was an engagement ring, okay? Because something started to switch. And no longer did that car have my heart, but this cute little girl did. And next thing you know, now here's the good news. In the grand scheme of things, I still have only one of those investments. And I think I made the right choice. Okay, because I get to see that engagement ring all the time, okay? The car, I don't even know where that thing is, okay? Although there are days when I'm thinking, oh, man, because, you know, those stupid things are worth $50,000 now, right? And I'm like, oh, man, I should have kept that dumb car. But then I'm thinking, no, I got Brenda. That's a much better deal, right? Because where we spend our stuff, it demonstrates where our heart is. It shows us where our priorities in life are. And the Bible is pretty clear about where the proper placement of our heart and our wealth really is. And it says, put your hope in God. So the proper placement of our hope is with God, not with stuff. And that's what we want to talk about for a few minutes today, is how do we properly place our hope in God? Because he tells us, put our hope in God who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. So what does it look like when we properly place our hope in God rather than in money? Well, the first, if we trust God, we will do what he says to do. We'll do the things that God says to do if we trust him. And so when it comes to our money, what does God tell us we're supposed to do with it? So that's kind of where we land today. If we trust him, we do what he says. Well, what does he say? Well, from the beginning in Scripture, God knew that money had this potential to be in definite competition for our heart, okay? And that God knew that, you know what, that the money and possessions that we have, it might pull our hearts away from him. And so early on, God said, hey, You need to get this right. And so God put in place ways for us to make sure that we were putting God first. And in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 and 10, it's a great passage. This is another one I'd encourage you to memorize. It comes not too far after that, you know, where it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he'll make your path straight. So in other words, you know, trust God, trust him. And then the next few, it says this, it says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. So one of the first things that I look at is this, and I'm going to give you three P's this morning that I think help us properly place our hope, okay? And the first is this, is priority giving, okay, priority. He says here, honor the Lord with your wealth with the first fruits, okay? In other words, what you get first, okay, the first stuff, and how this played out for the children of Israel, okay, was important because the children of Israel, you know, it was like they were farmers, they were people and shepherds and stuff like that. So it was like the first of the crops that came in, okay? So out of the first stuff that came in, you gave. And it goes on in that passage and it says, and if you do this, the God's promise, the result of priority giving, he says, then your barns will be filled to overflowing and your vats will brim over with new wine. In Nehemiah chapter 10, verse 35, now this is later, after all kinds of things have happened in the children of Israel, which is a whole other sermon, he says this, he says, we also assume the responsibility for bringing to the house of the Lord each year the first fruits of our crops and every fruit tree. Okay, so he's just saying all the stuff we get, everything we get, the first stuff, the first fruits, the first thing that we get, we give it to God. Now, what does that mean for us? It means for us, we give to God first, okay? And that's a great way to do, that's a great way to put God as obviously the priority is you give to God first. See, I am convinced that a lot of us give God out of our leftovers. A lot of us do. Now, being a youth pastor for a lot of years is really funny because you would go places with the youth group. It always cracked me up. We'd go to restaurants and things, and young people don't ever think about, like, a tip, right? They just are like, you know, they just want to get what they can and everything else, and then it's like they just kind of leave whatever's left over, right? Which usually isn't much, okay? Because they're going to figure out what is the maximum, you know, they're looking at their couple dollars and going, what is the maximum I can get with what I've got? And then at the end, they're like, you know, they got like, you know, 2 cents left. And it's like, well, that's what I got. And so they give it. And unfortunately, folks, I think a lot of us treat God that way. We kind of live our life the way we want to live our life. And then if we have leftover, then we're like, okay, how much of what I got left? We don't even just go, okay, here's the leftover, I'll give it all to him. We just go, how much of what I've got left over should I give to him? But the reality is we need to be giving to him first. So how do you do that? Well, and we'll get to what you give in a minute, but how do you do that? Well, it's like this. For us, at least, it's like we have a budget that we work with. Okay? And again, I encourage all of you who can go to Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace University. It's awesome. It'll help you walk through this. If you don't have a budget, I can tell you today, if you don't work off a budget, you probably aren't being the steward that God wants you to be. Okay? Because numbers are easy. Okay? Well, not for me, but for my daughter Hannah, who's a math major. But numbers are easy because they always add up, and numbers don't lie. Okay, and God says, hey, I want you to be faithful to what I've given you. And so you need to work off a budget. And in the budget, the very first line item in our budget is what we're going to give to God. The first thing, okay, that's where it starts. And then when we get it, it needs to go to him first, okay? It's the first thing that you give. And that tells us about the priority that we place on God. It's not just like wait and see what's left or wait and do this. I mean, we need to give to him first. So how do you do that? Well, again, in your budget you can do that. When you get your paycheck, you know, then it's like give to God first. You know, for some of you who do bill pay, okay, well just put that in first. You know, but it shows us that God is a priority. Make sure that you're giving to God first. You can go online, okay? You can go to the church website, and you can go to the church app, okay? We have a church app, and you can actually put in to give a recurring gift so that, whenever you get the check, you just know it's going to go first all the time. It's just, that's just going to go automatically. Because what we've discovered is this, there's a lot of people who give, from what I've been told. I have no idea what people give, how they give, when they give, all that kind of stuff. I have no clue about that. But what I've been told is that we, even as a church family, have this one tendency, is that we will give like when we show up, but if we don't show up, then we're like, well, I didn't go. Why would I give, you know? And so we give God out of our leftover. We give God, you know, if we don't make it here, we don't give. I would encourage you, you know what? Give to God first. Sign up. Do the reoccurring thing because then you know it's always happening. Now, there is a danger with that, and that's that you could forget. And that you don't know that you're even giving. I mean, it's not bad that you're giving, but it's like, you know what? you could get to the point where you just kind of almost ignore it. It's just happening. I got that taken care of. And we'll talk about that in a minute too. But that's not the way we want to approach it either. Okay? But we want to give God, we want to make God a priority, so we make giving a priority. The next thing, the next P is this, is percentage giving. Okay? Give to God first. And what should you give? Give a percent. Now, I want to go through this story with you that Jesus tells in the Bible. And it's in Mark chapter 12, and it starts in verse 38. And it says this. It says, as he taught, Jesus said, watch out for the teachers of the law. Okay, he says, they like to walk around in flowing robes and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces. They have the most important, where they have the most important seats in the synagogues and places of honor in the banquets. Then there's this interesting line. It says, they devour widows' houses, and for a show they make lengthy prayers. Okay, go back to that, the one just before. It says, they devour widows' houses. And I thought this was interesting because I had never really thought about, well, like, what's that mean? They devour widows' houses. Well, back in the day, you know, for women in that day and age, women didn't work outside the home or anything else. And if their husbands, you know, when their husbands passed away, it was like, how are they going to get taken care of? Well, the Pharisees in this day and some of these Jewish leaders, what they would do is they would realize that these women were in trouble, and they would literally, they would basically, you know, in some senses, they would scam them out of the houses that they had and create, make them indebted to them. And there's some interesting ways. I was reading in one commentary about how this would work, and they, you know, and they were thinking, oh, we're taking care of them. But the reality is they were really looking out for their own interests, because they were taking control of what these widows did have. And while they thought they were maybe, or at least they would say, well, we're helping them out, they were really benefiting themselves in the long run. Now, the reason I read you this is because this is kind of a unique setup. Jesus is amazing when he teaches. This is kind of an interesting setup for the next part of what Jesus is about to teach. So go to the next slide. And so this is the next part. He says, these men will be punished most severely. Then, it says, Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. And I thought, that's interesting. We make a big deal about how private giving is, right? And I'm like, Jesus goes over and he's like, you know, it's like if the offering plate's right here, Jesus is like just sitting here going like, all right, let's check this out. Let's like see what these people do, right? And I'm thinking, whoa. And then I start thinking, obviously, that whatever you do give, I mean, Jesus knows anyways, right? He's got a pretty good view. So he's watching what's happening here. And he says, many rich people came and they threw in large amounts, but a poor widow. This is so ironic because he just said, all these Pharisees are taking advantage of the widows and they're doing all this other stuff and they're trying to build themselves up and their own finances up and everything else. They're taking advantage of the widows. And then Jesus goes, all these rich people that come, they're throwing all this money in. And he says, but then comes along a poor widow, okay? The one who were, they were kind of scamming. And then he says, and the poor widow came and she put in two very small copper coins worth only a few cents, okay? And you're like, oh man, she doesn't have anything. Well, yeah, the guy's like messed things up. He says, calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more into the treasury than all the others. Those guys who thought they were doing for themselves, taking care of themselves, getting everything for themselves. And he says, the widow who they were scamming, she put in more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put everything, all she had to live on. Now, here's the thing. Usually when we look at this passage, we go, bad Pharisees, good widow, right? And we look at this, and what we do is we look at Jesus' compassionate heart for the widow and everything else. But the thing that we might miss about this is, what did Jesus notice? I mean, what caught the attention? Was it the amount that was given? Or was it the percent? I mean, come on. Joyce, put that back up there. She gave more. Did she really? I mean, he just said those other people threw in large amounts. They put in big amounts, big checks. But she gave more. So in God's economy, is God thinking more about amount or percent? Yeah, it's pretty obvious if we take a look at that passage, that God's looking at percent of giving, not amount. Because there's some people who could give a big amount and it's a horrible percent. Okay? And as we look at this passage, it's like when Jesus is sitting there watching what people are putting in, what does Jesus notice? What catches his attention the most? It's the percentage giving. It's not the amount giving. In fact, the amount giving can mess you up if you do it this way. So that's why I honestly believe the most important thing for us to do as we think about our giving is have priority giving, give it to God first, and give a percent of your giving, okay? Give a percent of your income. Now, how much percent should that be? Now, the Bible teaches this concept of the tithe, okay? Leviticus, it starts way back in the Old Testament, even before the law, but in Leviticus 27:30, it says, a tithe of everything from the land, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord. It is holy to the Lord. It's set apart for him. Okay, and this whole idea of the tithe was 10%. Towards the end of the Old Testament, in the book of Malachi, there's this interesting exchange between God and the prophet. And he says this in Malachi chapter 3. He says, will a mere mortal rob God? And then he says, yet you rob me. And we're looking around going, what? I mean, who would rob God, right? I thought about that because we had people break into the cars in the parking lot. I'm thinking, oh, they're in big trouble, right? But it's like, you know, who's going to rob God? He says, but you ask me, how are we robbing you? And then he says, in tithes and offerings. And then he says, because you've robbed him, because you haven't given the tithes and offerings, you're under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you're robbing me. And then he says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you don't even have room enough for it. In other words, if Jesus is blessing, you won't have room for it all, but don't go get a storage unit, okay? Now, here's the thing, and I understand how this works, because some people read this and they think about the concept of the tithe, and some people start to push back, okay? And I hear this all the time as a pastor when I'm talking with people. People start to push back. And some people, they make the mistake of saying, okay, but Ken, that was Old Testament stuff, and now we're living under grace. We sang all about grace, which was awesome this morning. Sing all about grace, and we're like, we're under grace, and so grace frees us up. The tithe no longer, you know, like applies to us, you know, and I hear people do that all the time. And they'll say, you know, grace frees us from having to tithe. And I read this amazing article last week from a guy named John Ortberg that was just kind of bouncing around in my head all week. And I started to think about this. Grace doesn't free you from having to give the tithe. What if grace frees you from the shackle of the tithe to do more? John Ortberg says this. He says, what if tithing is not opposed to grace at all? But what if tithing is actually a vehicle of God's grace to us? Take that statement for a minute. This is one that you shouldn't be looking at me. You should be writing this down, okay? Okay? What if tithing is not opposed to grace at all, but is actually a vehicle of God's grace? I let that ping around in my head for a while this week. And here's what I started to think about, is that God created you, he knows you, he's blessed you with stuff, but he knows your tendencies and mine. And my tendency is when I get stuff, is to go, woo, look what I got, and go spend it all, okay? That's why God gave me Brenda, okay? It's like, that's my human tendency. Spend all I can on me, or, you know, look out for my, if we're not careful, we get arrogant or we put our hope in wealth. God knows you and me so well that he said, what can I do to help them? Look at these people. If we're not careful, I mean, these people will just go crazy and they're going to put all their hope in their stuff and in their money. So how can I help them without like making it look crazy? What should I do? And he goes, well, you know what? I have to get them to quit living tight-fisted with their stuff and be open-handed with it. How am I going to do that? He says, well, let's start with, I'm just going to tell them, hey, what about, you know, I mean, I'm almost picturing like God in heaven having this discussion with himself, you know, God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are sitting down there like, what are we, it's like, oh, what about we'll get them to give. Okay, well, how much should they give? Well, we have to make it enough so that, you know, they kind of feel it, but then not so much that they, you know, freak out too bad. Okay. And I'm like, 10%, how about 10%? Well, I mean, what if God was like thinking, hey, tithing is going to be a great thing for them because it's going to be able to release them from putting their hope in junk and putting their hope in me. And they're going to demonstrate that right off the top that they love me more than they love their stuff. What if God gave us that vehicle because he knows us so well and he knows that we need it? I mean, that as I started to think about that, I thought, God, you are so brilliant. You are so good to me that you're actually telling me, hey, Ken, I love you so much that I don't want all the other junk to control you, so I'm going to help you. And he gave us this concept. I mean, what if God meant for your tithing to be a gift from him? I mean, that is pretty amazing. To make sure that our obedience, our worship, and our heart are locked into place on our Heavenly Father. I mean, if we only see it as a bad thing, we only see it as a bad thing when we focus on what we think that God wants to take from us. But what if we just focus on what God wants to do for us? Then actually tithing could be an amazing thing because he wants to bless us through it. And for some people who are like, oh, you know, that whole, yeah, but I still, you know, people have trouble getting over that, you know, it's this Old Testament thing. Jesus, I believe, does make it valid in the New Testament. But this was another thing that John Ortberg said that I thought was really good, is this whole idea that in Galatians chapter 3, verse 24, he talks about, you know, Paul talks about the law, and he says, so the law, that's the Old Testament basically, was our guardian until Christ came that we might be justified through faith. In other words, the Old Testament was there as a guardian to kind of keep us in line until Jesus could come, right? And when you take a look at that word for guardian in the original language, it almost has this concept of one who guides. And then I love this because John Ortberg says that tithing were the training wheels for giving. Okay, it's like God put on these training wheels for us and said, okay, here's how I want you to give, and these are your training wheels. So there you go. Go. Just put on the training wheels, and this is how I want you to. This is, because when you start learning to ride a bike, right, you put the training wheels on. It's like a guardian. It holds you up. It, like, helps you balance where you can't balance. And I'm thinking, this is brilliant, man. God just put on these training wheels and said, here's where you start. But we all know that training wheels are not good if you're riding in the Tour de France, okay? I mean, I've been watching, Devin's gotten into bike riding, mountain biking, and stuff like that. Devin, if I go put training wheels on your bike today, what are you going to do? Exactly, you're going to take them off, okay? When do you know it's okay? When do you know it's time to take the training wheels off? It's when the training wheels start slowing you down. Okay? It's when the training wheels start slowing down your growth. And I thought, man, you know, when you think about the whole idea of tithing, it's like, you know, now, is it because you want to ride slower? No, it's because you want to drive faster. Is it because you want to go to easier places or more difficult places? Is it because you want to do less or because you want to do more? And I'm thinking, man, that's such a great analogy for tithing. Tithing is this place where it's the training grounds, and it's good to take the training wheels off, but when you're ready to go to bigger places, better places, more places, that's when it's okay to take them off. Not when you go like, well, I just don't like these these training wheels because I want to go slower than this. But that's how a lot of people treat it. And so every other New Testament or Old Testament concept that Jesus teaches on in the New Testament, Jesus like jacks them up through the roof. It's like, you know, he says in Matthew chapter 5, you know, he says, you've heard it said in the Old Testament, don't murder, right? And we're like, yeah, don't murder, right? Well, nobody says, hey, we've been freed from that, so we can go murder now. Right? No, Jesus doesn't do that. He takes it the other way. He says, but I tell you, if you hate somebody, you've already committed murder in your heart. So Jesus makes it like tougher. And then he says, hey, you've heard it said, don't commit adultery. And he says, and then Jesus says, but I tell you, you know, because adultery, you guys all know what that is. He says, but I tell you, if you look lustfully at a woman, that you've already committed adultery in your heart. I mean, we don't look at that and go, well, hey, the Old Testament rule was adultery, and now we're under the New Testament, so woo, that one's off. We can go do whatever we want. That's not how it works, is it? But why is it that we do that so much in our minds and our hearts when it comes to the finances? I will tell you why. Because you've put your hope in wealth, and you are battling that like crazy. But Jesus is saying, there's a better way. Don't look at the tithing piece. Don't look at the giving, okay, as this shackle of requirement. Look at it as a gift of God's grace to help you move from there to there. Get off the front board and get on the second one, okay? Because God wants more for you. He wants more and better for you. All that he wants growth in your life. He does not want you to get stuck. So tithing is a great floor. It's a horrible ceiling. Okay? And what I've realized in my life is this. Is I've realized I am rich. And I know where that stuff came from. Now, just to be open with you. You know, I've had times in my life when I've struggled, okay? And it's interesting, because the tithing thing in my life has become, like I was taught from an early age, I've shared some of you the story before, when I was growing up I had three jars that my mom and dad gave me. One said God, one said saving, one said spending, okay? And my mom, I got a dollar a week. And my mom purposefully gave me 10 dimes. Okay, where did the first priority giving, first dime go? God jar, okay? Where did the second dime go? Okay, this is a hard one. Yeah, saving, okay? And then 8 went in the other one. I could do whatever I want with them, right? But I grew up that way. And so it actually, the tithing thing, I have to be honest, because my mom and dad did that for me when I was young, it became easy, actually too easy. Because I went for a period of time in my life when I did not even think about it. I honestly, it wasn't an act of worship for me. I treated it just kind of like paying your dues or paying your taxes, doing whatever else. I was just like, eh, that's what I do. It's just a line item in the budget. And guess what that became to me? A religious act. It wasn't an act of worship. I wasn't going, God, you are so amazing. You bless me all the time. I want to give to you. I'm going to make you a priority. I just did the tithe because that's what I was trained to do. And some of you are there. And that's all you've been doing. And I'm not saying that, you know, doing that is bad. I'm just saying that maybe you're stuck. Maybe it's time for a few of you to take the training wheels off and do something else. Now, there's some of you who tried to jump on the bike, and you're riding all over the place, and you're crashing, okay? Your finances have got you jacked up, okay? And maybe you need to put the training wheels on and catch your balance and learn. And some of you are going, whoa, Pastor Ken, 10%. Dude, you don't know our budget, okay? You don't know that, you know, I mean, to live here in Newbury Park, I mean, 10%, oh my gosh, there's no way that fits into our budget. And so here's what I would say. Okay, you know, then let's start off easy. Okay, we won't give you the bike that even has the pedals on it. We're going to give you the one that has, like, you know, no pedals or nothing. You just go easy and put training wheels on that one. Start off with 1%. Maybe it's 1%. Maybe it's 2%. Because I believe this. If you do what God tells you to do, if you start with percentage priority, you give it first and you give a percent, that you're going to recognize the difference in your heart and in your life and even in your finances, and God eventually is going to help you get to the place where 10% isn't even that big of a deal. But you're going to have to do it His way. If you do it your way, it will never work. Do it His way, and I guarantee you, it will work. And pretty soon, the 1% goes to 2%, goes to 4%, ends up at 10%. And then the deal is this. It's the third P. It's progressive. Progressive giving. It means don't get stuck there. Don't get stuck there like I did. I've been stuck there before. And I realized that my giving was just a religious act, and honestly, it wasn't doing a whole lot here. I thought, if you ask me, I'd say, well, I'm being obedient or whatever. Great, but did God really have my heart? And the reality is God wants our heart. And so, you know, I think it's so important for us to do it. Now, if some of you are skeptical, if some of you are saying, okay, this is just, you know, I've heard about this before, and this is, you know, maybe you're a visitor today, and you're like, oh my gosh, I came at the perfect day, right? But I hope you're learning something here, okay? God loves you so much that He will give you everything. He gave us His Son, but He will also help you deal with what He's given to you. And so the reality is if you're skeptical, if you're like, oh, this is a church just trying to get the money or whatever else, then hear this. I've said this before. Then listen to me carefully. Then give somewhere else. Okay? Give somewhere else. Tithe somewhere else. Now, don't tithe somewhere stupid. Okay? If you need to know how to do that, I'd be happy to share it with you. There's lots of great, you know, Christian organizations you might be able to do that with for a bit. Now, should you keep doing that? I don't think so, because I think the Bible clearly teaches you ought to give where you're at and where you're living, where you're serving. But I think if you're skeptical enough to go, then do that for a while. And then once God's taught you enough, then you can come back and start doing it right. But just listen and do what He says. And believe me, and then use progressive giving. Okay, in that Malachi passage, I think it's awesome because he says, how have we robbed you? We've robbed you in tithes, okay, and offerings. And you're like, tithes, we talked about that. That's a 10% thing. Now, what's this offering thing? Back for the people in the Old Testament, it was like you could bring an offering at any time and just go, God has been so good to me, I just want to praise Him. I just want to do something good, you know. I just want to do this, you know, for kingdom work, for whatever else. You just bring whatever you want and give it to the Lord, okay. So if you get the tithe thing down, the 10% thing down, then it's time to you really get to take the training wheels off and move into the offering area. And you know, it's been fun. Brenda and I have actually grown so much in our lives talking about this, because now we not only get to tithe, you know, to the local body here, but we have friends who are in ministry, we have ministry things we're involved in, we're doing all these things. And I got to tell you something, folks, you can't outgive God. And He'll do amazing things in your life. And you know, I've watched this because I get so worried about us, because I think sometimes we're not even giving God a good tip. You know, I've had 4 daughters who've all worked as waitresses, okay? They all worked at Country Harvest. And I asked them one time when I was studying for this, I said, what do you think if people come in and they only give you a 10% tip? And all of my daughters were like, well, I would think that they thought I gave them bad service if all they get is 10%, right? Because, like, everybody knows, I mean, at the minimum nowadays, it's kind of like, you know, double the tax or whatever. I mean, you know, and then if it's good service, you give 20%, right? I mean, isn't that kind of the norm these days? So if you just gave 10%, it's kind of like almost an insulting tip to somebody. And I'm thinking, wow, what if I translate that to God? I don't even tip Him good. And should I even be thinking that I'm tipping God? How ridiculous is that? And again, it's not because God is after your money. He is after your heart, and he knows that you and I have the tendency to go there and to put our hope somewhere else. And so God is saying, that will not get you into kingdom living. We got to get here. Why? Because God richly provides. I mean, how many of you would sit down today and go, God's a horrible provider? No, God richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. And if that's the case, then guess what, folks? Then we need to get on board with him. Because you know what? Being rich is not about just what you do. Being good at being rich, it's not just about what you do with the money you have. It's what the money you have does to you. And the question is where's it taking your heart? Where's it steering your heart and your life? There's a growth cycle that happens in giving. Is God has already taken the first step and he's blessed you. We're rich. The next step is we learn to give back to him. And the Bible says as we learn to truly give, then God blesses us again and blesses us more. And then so he blesses us again, and then we give more, and then he blesses us, and we give more. And it's this amazing cycle of growth. It's not meant to get us stuck, folks, because God wants to continue to provide you with everything, okay? And it doesn't say provide you with everything for your survival. I think he'll do that. He actually wants to provide you with everything for your enjoyment, but you got to do it his way. And so for the next couple weeks, we're going to talk about how we do it his way, not ours. All right, so we're going to enter into this time of communion now where we're reminded again all that God has blessed us with, and most importantly, our salvation in Jesus Christ. And if that doesn't get you excited about God's grace, I don't know what will. But let's pray, and then in a few moments, the ushers are going to come and serve communion. And as they do that, just reflect on what God truly has blessed you with. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you today for your grace and for your mercy, for your love. And Father, we pray that, Lord, we will understand that your grace is so much deeper than we can even understand. Lord, forgive us when we just have a surfacey level of grace that still says, what's in it for me? And Father, help us to realize that your grace is deeper still, and that your grace calls us into these deep places where we give you completely our heart. Because knowing that, Lord, as we give you our heart, that God, you have so much better for us, and you want to do so much more in our lives. So God, give us today the ability to understand your grace and understand the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross for us. We thank you, Lord, and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.